I started playing bass when I was 14, 15 years old. Friends of mine started a band, and then they needed a bass player, so I figured, why not? I'll play bass. So after that, I bought my first bass, and I decided to really practice, and I wanted to be the best I could be. So I asked my older brother, who should I listen to? Who's the best bass players? And he told me Stanley Clarke and Chris Squire. So those are my early influences, and I couldn't play like them, but I just would always hear this really fast bass line stuff. So I just practice on playing fast and trying to get around on the instrument. And so that's kind of how I started on playing bass. So after I got to a certain level and I studied some music theory in college, I decided to go to Musicians Institute. So I moved to Los Angeles in the spring of 1985, and I went to Musicians Institute, which would be BIT, the Bass Institute, and started studying. And I met Paul Gilbert, the guitar player from Racer X and Mr. Big and Paul Gilbert. But I met him early on. He was looking for a drummer, and my roommate was a drummer. And so Paul gave him a call, and then he told him about me, that I played bass. And Paul said, well, I'm looking for a bass player as well, so see if your roommate wants to come. So we both went down and we jammed with Paul, and he wasn't so hot on the drummer, but he really liked my playing. And so 3 months into the school, I'm playing in a band with this guy, Paul Gilbert, who at the time everybody at the school was talking about because he was just so amazing. And so then we started a band together, and it was just Paul and me, and he had a record deal with Shrapnel Records, and we were gonna do his debut record, and we were gonna call it Paul Gilbert, and then I really wanted to call it a band. So we came up with the name Racer X because we both were fans of Speed Racer, the cartoon. And then we needed a drummer, and he had heard about Harry. So Harry gets a phone call from Paul, and Harry starts playing with us. So it's Harry, and it's Paul, and it's me. And we would go rehearse at Musicians Institute. All of us were students at one time or another. So Paul and Harry and I needed to rehearse, and we didn't have a lot of money, so we couldn't rent out a rehearsal room. So we all went to the music school, to Musicians Institute, and they had this big rehearsal room, and it was called P1, and it was always available at 6 in the morning because no musician wanted to wake up and get there at 6 in the morning to rehearse. So Paul said, well, why don't we get there and we'll have the room for 3 hours? So every day, 5 days a week, we would rehearse from 6 in the morning to 9 in the morning, just doing Racer X, just shredding. And so we'd get there, nobody would be there, and then within an hour, 2 hours, we'd have all these guys outside our room watching us rehearse. And then we started the band. It was us three, Racer X, and then we needed a singer, and we added Jeff Martin on vocals, and we went up to the San Francisco Bay Area to a city called Cotati. And the studio is called Prairie Sun, and we recorded Street Lethal, which was the first Racer X record, on Shrapnel Records. And so we did that. I think we played once at a Guitar Wars show event at Gazzari's in Hollywood. It was Harry and Paul and me, and Paul won the Guitar Heroes contest, and I think he won some money or whatever. And that's how Racer X started. And then after that, Harry moved back to Austria, and so Paul and I needed to find a drummer. So we found Scott Travis. Scott Travis joins the band, and we're working on the second record. And then Paul wants to add this student of his that he felt was really good, and that was Bruce Bouillet. So then we go to record the second record, which was Second Heat, and that's Bruce Bouillet, Paul Gilbert, myself, Scott Travis, and Jeff Martin on vocals. So we do that record, and that's the record that had Scarified, which was probably the biggest song that Racer X was known for. And we still never toured because we didn't have a booking agent. We just didn't know how to do any of that stuff then. And we did a live record, and then after the live record, we broke up. because Paul got an offer to go join Mr. Big. Paul joins Mr. Big, and then Scott and Bruce and I decide to continue on. We find a singer, we find this guy John Corabi, we start our band up, and then Scott gets into Judas Priest. And then so Bruce and I get another drummer, and we start our band The Scream, and then The Scream gets a record deal with Hollywood Records, and that was, you know, that is the end of that era for my playing. So after The Scream, you know, we have a record deal, we get dropped, and we had another singer, and just we just didn't know what we were doing. And so I just decided to really develop my own playing, because that was one thing I was in control of. So I got my own apartment where I lived by myself in Venice Beach, California, and I got a fretless off my old bass teacher, and I just spent 3 years playing fretless every day, and I really wanted to be a really good fretless player. And I think after 3 years, I started to sound really good, and I think my voice started to come on with fretless playing. And then I started my band Big Sur, which was, in the beginning, it was Tim Comerford, who plays bass in Rage Against the Machine. He played bass and drums. I played bass. And then Bruce Guyer from Racer X played keyboards, and then he recorded everything. And then we had Lisa Papineau, who was a vocalist, and she sang on everything. And then Tim quit the band, Bruce quit the band, and then it was just Lisa and me. And then Big Sur just continued. We put out one record, and then we did, you know, shows in Los Angeles or whatever. But I think I started to, like, get known for more for my fretless style playing, because all of Big Sur is fretless bass playing. And after that, I ended up in Mars Volta. They were looking for a bass player. A friend of mine recommended me. They called me up when they were on tour. They had a temporary basis, and I went and I auditioned, and it didn't seem like they were auditioning anybody else. And, you know, within 2 days, Omar told me, the guitar player told me that, I was going to do the gig, that I got the gig. And so I was in Mars Volta touring for their first record that Flea had played bass on, and I was on tour for the next 2 years just touring for that record, and in the meantime writing and rehearsing the second record, which is Francis and Mute. Omar had all these ideas, we would rehearse them, and we ended up coming up with Francis and Mute. And then, I mean, record after record, we, you know, one drummer's gone, another one comes in, and John Theodore was gone, and then we had Thomas Pridgen. We had D'Anthony Parks, and he was in it temporarily, and then we found Thomas Pridgen. And then Thomas was in the band for 2 or 3 years, and then he's out of the band. Dave Elitch was in the band for a year, I guess. I can't really remember. And then we ended up getting D'Anthony Parks back in the band, and then we toured and played from 2010 to 2012, where the last Mars Volta show was 2012. After the practicing the fretless, pretty much the fretless was all about trying to sound good on it. So having your intonation sound good, and just being able to really understand how different it is from the fretted instrument, because a fretted instrument isn't as expressive as the fretless. And so that's a lot of work, but it's not really so much in, like, practicing with a metronome or sight reading or anything. It's just about playing it constantly and listening to yourself and seeing what the instrument does. And then when I got into Mars Volta, I pretty much just practiced. When I auditioned for them, I just learned that album back and forth. I just memorized it completely. And I really, you know, when I went into it, even though I'd been in a lot of auditions and situations where they say, well, you just do what you think you should be doing, like, whatever your style is, we want to hear what you do. I always believe that they really do still want what's on the record. So I learned exactly what Flea did on the first record. And I played it, as far as I know, I played it note for note. And so when I went to audition for them, it was seamless. Like, it was easy. They heard it sounded just like what they recorded. So I think that's why I got the gig. But any of the situations I've ever been in, I pretty much, whatever they hand me, I learn it note for note. and make it sound exactly what they're familiar with. Because I think if you come at them with something that's too different, it's just too much too soon. So I have always been a big believer of just giving them exactly what they hand you, and then you can slowly embellish it and make it your own. But I do believe in the beginning, you have to give them what they're comfortable with. And then that's all I did. I just would practice technique over and over, practicing the songs and trying to perfect playing them well. And it's mostly technique, because I'm not a reader, and I'm not really based off music theory. I'm really based off technique and feel. And so I think that's where, you know, my abilities are the strongest. Mm-hmm. Well, in I think in Europe, I think the fans tend to be really enthusiastic about any kind of music that's very unique to a certain style or sound. So with Mars Volta, I think that we were so unique, and so I think they were really excited when we would come tour here, because it was like nothing else that they could ever hear anywhere else in Europe. So I think that we always made sure that we had a really good jam approach, and we would really improvise a lot live. And then in the States, the difference with the U.S. is a little bit more jaded in certain cities, so it's a little bit harder to like impress. Like if you're in New York or L.A., it's a lot harder to impress them, and so you just kind of have to care less almost, and then hope that they get it and they're into it. But you know, in traveling a lot, like you just have to make sure that you're doing your best to be rested and make sure that you're warming up, because you're not always used to playing in that time zone, so you have to adapt. So I've always stretched a lot, I've always warmed up a lot, and I always drink a lot of water just to make sure you're hydrated. Well, with Letterman, the one thing that we had to our advantage was that Omar and Cedric had done the Letterman show with at the drive-in, so they warned us early on how cold it was going to be. And when you go into that studio where they filmed David Letterman show, it's ice cold. So I just knew to make sure I was warm, and you know, I kept doing push-ups and stair climbs just to make sure I was warm when I walked in there. And when you walk in there, it's cold. So I just make sure that, you know, it's just really weird, because you get thrown up there, you get one rehearsal, cold rehearsal, and you play it through the song, and then you just hope everything goes okay. And so we went in there and we did it, and it's just such a blast. It's meaning it's so fast and it's so intense, and next thing you know, it's over. And you know, the song that we did on Letterman was such a crazy song with a lot of busy drumming that you just hope that you made it to the end, and we did. And I think part of that performance led to us getting the Grammy, because I think a lot of people who vote for the Grammy would have never heard of us had it not been for the Letterman show that we were on. I mean, yeah, I think all of us were a little nervous, but you're no more nervous than playing in front of a bunch of musicians. Mars Volta, whenever we did festivals, there would always be a handful of musicians on both sides of the stage watching us. And so you're always playing in front of your peers or bands you admire or bands that are very successful, so you just get used to handling that kind of stress. I'm always a little nervous, like you're just on edge a little, but I don't ever get overwhelmed with it, because I've been doing it for so long. I mean, from Racerx, from day one, we were a musician band, so all we ever had was really good musicians with their arms folded like this, watching us play, and you're nervous. I remember the first NAMM show I ever played in Chicago. We had Stu Hamm, Joe Satriani, and Steve Vai watching us in a small little room. And, you know, I was a young kid. I was super nervous. But after years and years of this, you just don't get that nervous anymore. With Racer X, I still keep in contact with Harry, and I keep in contact with Scott. Paul, I keep in contact usually through email. He's always on the road and stuff, so it's not easy to see him. I saw Bruce at a NAMM show last year. And then Jeff, I text with Jeff, and I see him at NAMM show every year, it seems like. And then like Mars Volta, I don't see a lot of those guys a lot because everybody tours a lot. So I'm still really good friends with John, the drummer, John Theodore. And I'm good friends with Cedric. I still have a band with Cedric called Zavalas, and we are still doing that. So, you know, but it's, you know, when people tour as much as they do, you just, you lose contact with people because you're all so busy. Wow. I mean, like anything, like how much did music change from the 50s to the 60s, from the 60s to the 70s? I mean, from the 80s into what I, you know, did in the 2000s, it's just completely different. It's, you know, when I joined Racer X, I wasn't listening to heavy metal. I was listening to bands like Killing Joke or more new wave and punk. And I could really play fast. So when I met Paul, he asked me to join and I said, sure. But it's wasn't my first choice of genre of music. But then I ended up playing heavy metal in the 80s. And then in the 90s, I went kind of back to more punk or new wave and stuff. And then I really got into hip hop and I really, you know, couldn't figure out how to play in hip hop. And it's just so funny that I'm here in Munich now and I'm in a hip hop group, finally. But I just think that you just have to, if you really love music, and you'll find a way to play it. So I've always loved hip hop and I always knew I wanted to play in a hip hop band, and now I am. And with Mars Volta, I think it was one of those things that I always wanted to play in a band that had so many different styles so I could maybe show all the different styles that I felt I was decent at. And so when I met them, I heard Latin grooves, I heard funky grooves, I heard Afrobeat stuff, and I really wanted to play that stuff. And here I got in a band that they did everything. So I've been pretty lucky. I've been very fortunate in my career that I've gotten to play so many great bands and so many great musicians, just really the best musicians. I'm very, very grateful. I think in the 80s when I played in Racer X, it was like all of our first real band, I think. I mean, everybody was in their own local bands, but it was our first real band where we were trying to get a record deal or whatever. And so we were friends and we were buddies and we, you know, were so entrenched in each other's lives. And that kind of experience only happens when you're really young. And after that, it was always just bands, any kind of situation I was in, it was, I get hired, and then they become your friends. Mars Volta wasn't touring anymore, and so I always knew Dan, the automator who runs Deltron. And I called him up, and they needed a bass player, so I said, yeah. Over the years, my playing's changed a lot. When I first joined Racer X, I mention this a lot when I teach at music schools. I used to sit with a metronome and practice my scales at different BPMs. And Paul, I learned it kind of from Paul more than anybody, but Paul would always tell me, he would call me up and say, oh, I'm playing 16th note triplets at 190 BPMs. So then I would have to get up there with him, so because he would write all these unison lines that I would have to do on bass. And for anybody who doesn't understand, that guitar is a smaller scale instrument and Paul's hands are about 10 times bigger than mine. And so I'm playing a bigger, but it was a lot of work, but I would sit there and practice just speed. So I would try to get my 16th note triplets up to 200 or whatever. And so every day we would get better and faster. And then over the time, I like I mentioned earlier, I went into fretless playing, which has nothing to do with speed in the beginning. It was just about intonation and sound. And then now playing in Deltron 3030 and the last couple years in Mars Volta, I kind of turned my playing around where I was playing more flat wound bass, which means like the strings are flat wound, so they're not as trebly. I'm not playing as fast. I was playing more streamlined, I would say. And the tone is a lot more vintage style, more like James Jamerson or a lot of the older 60s basses. There's not a lot of high end. It's just functions as bass kind of originally was intended, which for upright, which is flat wound. And so you just kind of go for more of a low end sound as opposed to a treblier sound. So that kind of changed. And also I got a lot in Mars Volta. I really got into effects. I was doing effects before I joined Mars Volta, but I think I only had like maybe 30, 40 pedals. And then over the course of Mars Volta, I got my collection up to around 400 or 500 pedals. And it's just an obsession. I just love getting my bass sound to sound completely different than what it sounds like to anybody else. And then I decided after Mars Volta, I started a website called pedalsandeffects.com. And that's my website where I basically discuss my obsession of pedals and how I use them. And then I've had guests on my website and we discuss how they use them. I've had Tim LaFay, who was recently on the cover of Bass Player Magazine. He came into my studio and we talked about his pedals and how he uses them. Yannick Wasdala, Jonathan Hischke from Dot Hacker. I've had guitar players like Nick Reinhardt for Taramello. He's an awesome guitar player with effects. And so I just kind of have different people come in and give me their different angles. I've even had drummers. I had Troy Ziegler, who played in Big Sur early on, and he's an awesome drummer, but he also does like sound treatments for groups that he's in. And so we just discuss pedal use and doing sound design basically through pedals. So if you're interested in that, you can check out my website, pedalsandeffects.com, where I have, I don't know, 30 or 40 videos of just pedal talk, just different pedals or different pedal combos or interviews. But you can check it all out there at my website. Yes, so because Mars Volta was such a unique band, Omar was already deep into pedals himself. He had a lot more pedals than I did when I joined the band. And he was always going for different sound creations. And he really came up with some pretty wild, interesting sounds that I don't think any guitar player has ever, come to. It's just, big, giant walls of sound. And I was always trying to do something similar at times, and then something more low-endy, more subby. And so my sound changed because I wanted to just make sure that I was the biggest low-ended sounding bass player. I had this one pedal called the Meatbox that a lot of guys know about, which is basically a sub-harmonic synthesizer pedal, and then Microsynth, which has a sub pedal on it. I was just trying to get giant, big, low end, so when I hit it, our sound would be giant, especially. In the end of Mars Volta, it was really exciting because there was so much electronic music, and that's all driven by low end. And we would see electronic music or hip hop music, and they'd have this giant low end, and then a rock band would go up after them, and they would sound this big compared to what the electronic music would sound like. So I decided to throw in a lot more low end, so when we would come on out there, an electronic or a hip hop group, our sound would be that big because we were covering that kind of low end. So it really changed my whole approach, because when you're playing that low endy, you can't play fast because it doesn't articulate in the speakers. So you slow your stuff down and you let things sustain more and you let the pedal do the work where it just throws out the low end. I'd say the most important role that I try to fulfill is just the foundation for everything, and definitely Mars Volta is the easiest example. I know that I had to be as solid as I could because everybody listened to me. It would always, when we would be at sound check, everybody would always make sure that they had my bass in their in-ears because it was just the foundation of knowing where we were at the song or in the improv section or whatever. And so I think my role has always been to just be the strongest foundation that I could. I think because I've had such great fortune in playing with amazing drummers, I think the thing I learned the most about is a great drummer is a drummer who listens to the music as opposed to a drummer who plays and then the band has to listen to him. And so I think it's important for any drummer to really be conscious of what everybody's doing, and or at least whoever's the foundation and who's directing it. And so if you go into it with that, I think it's that. And I also, the one thing I always, and if I any drummer ever asks my opinion, I always say that really focus on the fundamentals and more than anything else. I just see too many musicians, especially drummers, working on technique stuff that they'll never use unless they're doing a drum solo. And I always recommend just practice your time or practice your grooves. I think that will get you a lot further in your career than if you're practicing some technique that you'll never use unless you do a drum video or something. I think the one thing that I get asked a lot when I teach, whether it's in a music school or a private or whatever, even through my website, they always want to know how to get gigs or how do they make a career out of it. And I can say that you should be a great bass player, which definitely helps, but I really think it's about getting along and making sure that you get along with everybody in your band or your situation. Your personality goes so much further than anything else. I recently spoke to Abe Laborio Jr. about this, and he said the same thing. He said that when you're an artist, you're already in such a vulnerable position and situation, and so it's in order for you to be as confident as you can be to do what you do, you have to be surrounded by people that make you feel comfortable. And so it's really being that personality that people feel they can be comfortable around. I mean, I'm sure Paul McCartney feels incredibly comfortable around Abe Laborio Jr. And I've always recommended that to anybody who wants to do this as a career. Just be a good personality. Be a really good, solid person. Really easy to be around human being. And I think you'll succeed. People will want you in their band or situation, and they'll fight for you to be in it because you're such a good dude. You know, it's always better to be in a band with good dudes, for sure. Makes the gig a lot funner. We'll be right back.
We'll be right back.